Now let's see about thread libraries in operating system. In order to implement threads, we use thread libraries. Thread library provides an API. API means application programming interface. API contains a collection of functions which are useful for creating and managing the threads. Here mainly there are two types of threads are available. The first one is Pthreads. P stands for POSIX thread, whereas second one is Java threads. So in this video we are going to discuss about how to implement Pthread as well as how to implement Java threads. First let's see how to implement Pthreads. Here what we are doing is we are writing a thread program in order to calculate the sum of first n natural numbers. Let the number is 3, then the sum of first 3 numbers. So 1 plus 2 plus 3 means 6. So 6 will be the output. So for that we have written C program as well as Java program. So Java program with the help of Java threads, C program with the help of Pthread or POSIX thread. Let's see the program. First statement, hash include pthread.h. So in order to create this program, we have to make use of several library functions and several constants. All those are available in pthread.h. Next one, hash include stdio.h. Here we are using printf and scanf functions. In this program we are using only printf function. So printf function is available in stdio.h. Next, sum is a global variable. So we know what is a global variable. We can make use of that variable throughout the program. If we have 10 functions, then we can make use of that variable in all the 10 functions. Okay. And the next one is runner function. Here runner is of type some pointer of which accepts a void pointer. So void star parameter param. So this is nothing but function declaration. The major advantage of the void pointer is void pointer stores address of any variable. If you take int pointer stores only address of integer variable. If you take float pointer, it stores address of float variable. Whereas void pointer stores address of any variable. Okay. Here in this program we are using some function in main function as well as this runner function. So that's why we are declaring sum as global variable. Next, this is nothing but main function definition. Int main, here we are writing the program with the help of command line arguments. We know what is command line arguments. The arguments which are supplied to the main function from the command prompt. So from the command prompt we have to pass the arguments. It accepts two parameters. The first parameter is argc of type integer. The second parameter is star argv of type character. Argc will give the number of arguments that we passed, argument count. Whereas char star argv of it stores the arguments that we passed here. Okay. Let us assume that here name of the program is some cmd, cmd.c. So first compilation will be over, next execution. So while execution we have to specify as name of the file and number. So if you specify 3 here, then we will get output as sum of first 3 numbers. If you specify 5 here, then we will get output as sum of first 5 numbers. So here argc will contain 2 now, because we totally passed 2 arguments. Whereas argv of 0 contains cmd, argv of 1 contains 5. So argv stands for argument vector. This is a pointer character array. Let's see the main function here. So pthread underscore t tid. So tid is nothing but thread identification number. Every thread will have an identification number. So that is represented with the help of tid. So this tid is declared using this data type pthread underscore t. So this data type is available in pthread.h. Next, every thread will have some attributes. By using that attribute, we can give additional attributes to the thread, as well as we can change the attributes of the thread. So for that, we need to declare an attribute.
So ATTR specifies thread attributes, which is of type pthread underscore ATTR underscore T. So this is a data type. This is nothing but variable. So by using this ATTR, we can changes or we can add or we can modify the attributes of the thread. Next, in order to set the attributes for the thread, we use this statement pthread underscore ATTR underscore. Here we are using init. So init stands for initialization. So here we are setting some attributes to the thread, or if you want, we can get attributes of the thread with the help of this statement ampersand ATTR. So here we need to specify the address of that attribute variable ampersand ATTR. Okay. Now let's see the next statement. This statement is very, very important statement. In order to create the thread, we use a command called pthread underscore create. So pthread underscore create method allows us to create a thread. It accepts four arguments. The first argument is thread identification number. The second argument is that attribute information. Third argument is function. Fourth argument is that value we are passing. Here, identification number, thread identification number is equal to TID. So we need to specify ampersand TID here. Next, attribute information is available in ATTR. So ampersand ATTR. So on which function we are calling here? Here the entire thread code is available in runner function. So the runner function. Next, RV of 1 means, so what we are doing here, we are calculating the sum of the first 5 natural numbers. That 5 resides in RV of 1. So whenever the statement is executed, then the control goes to the runner function. Okay. But here we have a statement called pthread underscore join here. Here the major advantage of join method is join method blocks the main function. So here the main function will be blocked until the runner function will gets executed. So the main function will wait until runner function will gives the result. So now the main function won't execute until the runner function execution is completed. So for that purpose we are using join method pthread underscore join of. So here what is the thread we are executing here? TID. So TID means what? It belongs to the runner function. So now this main function will wait until this runner function will get executed. We have to pass null as the second argument here. So now the control goes to the runner function. So here this parameter is nothing but this value we are passing. Here what is the value we are passing here? RV of 1. RV of 1 means what? 5. So now param value is 5. But here it is taking, here that value is stored in this RV vector. So RV is nothing but a character array, that is nothing but a string. So we have to convert that string into a number. So that should be done with the help of this statement. Int I upper is equal to a to I, array to integer of parameter. Actually here 5 will be stored as a string. So this 5 string will be converted to integer with the help of this statement. Now upper contains this integer. Okay. Next s is equal to 0. Next, for I is equal to 1, I less than or equal to 5, I plus less, sum is equal to sum plus I. This is the logic for sum of first 5 numbers. So first, what is the value of s? 0. So 0 plus 1 means 1. Next I becomes 2, let upper value is 3, let here the value is 3, so 2 is less than or equal to 3, condition is 2, so 1 plus 2 means 3, next 3 plus 3 means 6. Next pthread underscore exit of 0, it will destroys the thread. A thread is created with the help of pthread underscore create function, whereas a thread is destroyed with the help of this function, pthread underscore exit function. And what is the value here? 6. Next control goes to the main function. So now this thread execution is over. So the remaining statement will be executed. What is the sum value? 6. So this is the output here. So in this way we can calculate sum of first n natural numbers with the help of the threads. Now let's see the Java threads here. How we can calculate the sum of the first three numbers with the help of the threads. Here we have three classes. The first class is sum class. The second class is summation class, whereas the third class is driver class. Okay. So sum class, summation class, driver class. So driver class is the main class because main method is present in driver class. First let's see about sum class.
Here S is uppercase letter.
Next int sum.
Here sum is a variable. We know the naming conventions for a variable. So variable always begins with lowercase letter.
So here in sum, all the letters are lowercase letters. Okay. Why? Because here two variables should not be the same. If we give capital S here, then it will give the compilation error. Why? Because class is declared with the name sum. So here we are using capital S, here we are using small s.
Here the sum class mainly contains two methods. The first method is getSum method, whereas second method is setSum method. Okay. Let's say the prototype of the getSum method, int getSum, return sum. So getSum method returns sum value.
For space constraints, I am writing here. Next is setSum method, initializes the sum here. Okay. The return type of the setSum method is void int sum. Here the local variable is, the instance variable is sum, as well as local variable is sum. So this is called as local variable, this is called as instance variable, both are same. So then in order to access the instance variable, we use this operator. So this dot sum is equal to sum.
So sum class mainly contains two methods. First method getSum method, second method setSum method. GetSum method returns sum value, whereas setSum method assigns a value to the sum. Now let's see about the summation method. Class summation implements tunable. We can create a thread in two ways. First one by extending thread class, second one by implementing runnable interface. Here we are using the second approach, that is by implementing the runnable interface. If it is an interface, then we have to use this implements keyword. This runnable interface is available in lang package. In Java, lang is the default package, so there is no need to import java.lang. If you want, we can write that package also. In summation, what we are doing is, let's see the logic here. Int upper, so this upper contains the largest value, let the value is 3. That means we are calculating the sum of first 3 numbers. Let the value is 5. That means we are calculating the sum of the first 5 numbers. That value will be stored in upper. Next year, that getSum as well as setSum resides in the sum class. So for that purpose, we have created an object for the sum class. So object is sum value is the object for the sum class. Next here we have a constructor. Summation is the class name. So name of the constructor is summation. It accepts through two parameters. The first parameter is upper, which is of type integer. The second parameter is sum value, which is an object of the class sum. So here upper and sum value are instance variables, whereas this upper and this sum value are local variables. When instance variables and local variables both are same, then we can access instance variable with the help of this operator.
So this dot upper is equal to upper, this dot sum value is equal to sum value.
Next here, we can write the logic for the thread. The entire implementation of the thread is provided by overriding the run method.
So we have a method called run method.
So by overriding the run method, we have to write the logic for the thread. Here our logic is, we have to calculate the sum of the first n natural numbers.
Okay. Let's see the logic here. Int s is public void run. This is the prototype of the run method. Int s is equal to 0. For int I is equal to 0, or we can write as I is equal to 1. I less than or equal to upper, let the upper value is 3. So 1 less than or equal to 3. So s is equal to s. What is s value? 0. 0 plus 1, 1. Next 1 plus 2, 3. 3 plus 3, 6. Next, sum value dot this. Next we have to store this value in the corresponding sum with the help of the setSum method. Okay. For that purpose, we are using this statement. Sum value dot. Here, what is the object for the sum class? Sum value. Object name dot. What is the name of the method? SetSum of s. Why? Because here, in order to get the sum or in order to set the sum, we have two methods. But those two methods are not available in summation method. Summation method contains only thread logic. So that logic resides in what? This sum class. Okay. So that's why we have to call this method. So whenever the statement is executed, then the control goes to the setSum method of the sum class. What is the value here? If we add the first three natural numbers, then the output is 6. Now 6 will be passed to the sum. This dot sum is equal to sum. Now sum contains 6. Now let's see the main class. That is, let the name of the main class is driver. So public static void main string args throws exception.
Here we have to handle the exceptions. Why? Because here we are using t.join method. So whenever we want to use join method, then we must handle the exception with the help of try catch or by throwing the exception. Otherwise it generates interrupted exception. Here in place of this exception we can write interrupted exception also. Okay. And next, here first here we are creating an object for the sum class. Why? Because here we need to get that sum value. So that sum value is available in sum. Here we have a method called getSum method. So in order to access the getSum method, we need to create the object for the sum class. Next, int upper is equal to integer dot parse int of args of 0. Here let us assume that we are executing the program from the command prompt. So we will pass the input from the command prompt. Let us assume that we pass the input as 3. So now args of 0 now contains 3. So by default that argument will be taken as a string. So why? Because here we have what? String argument vector. String argument vector. Okay. So it will take the 3 as a string. So we have to convert that string into integer. That should be done with the help of integer wrapper class. Integer wrapper class contains parse int method. So int upper is equal to integer dot parse int of args of 0. So whenever the statement is executed, then the string 3 will be converted to integer 3. So now upper contains integer 3. Now we have to call this constructor. For that, first we need to create the thread. A thread is created with the help of this statement. Thread t is equal to new thread of. Here we have to call this summation constructor. For that, we know that if we create an object for the class, then automatically the corresponding constructor will be called. New summation will create an object for the summation class. And for the constructor, we have to pass upper and object as the parameters. So whenever the statement is executed, then the corresponding summation constructor will get executed. What are the arguments that we are passing here? Upper means 3, whereas that object information. Okay. So upper 3 will be stored here, as well as that object information will be stored here. Next, some initialization will be performed here. Next, t.start. So whenever t.start method is executed, then operating system contains then JVM. Here any Java program is executed with the help of Java Virtual Machine. Java Virtual Machine contains a thread scheduler. Then if the CPU is free, then thread scheduler allocates thread to the operating CPU. So CPU starts executing the thread. Here there is no need to call the run method explicitly. So whenever t.start method is executed, then the operating system, then the thread scheduler. Whenever t.start method is executed, then the thread scheduler will check whether CPU is free or not. If the CPU is free, then thread scheduler allocates CPU to the corresponding thread. So now CPU starts executing the run method. So whenever we call the t.start method, then automatically CPU will execute the run method. Okay. So we know the logic here. So whenever t.start is called, then this run method will get executed. So here what is the output? 6 is the output. And then setSum method will assign. SetSum method will pass that sum value to 6. Now sum value is 6. Let the n value is 3. So 1 plus 2 plus 3 means 6. Okay. Next, t.join method. The major advantage of this join method is, whenever join method is called, then the remaining statements in the main thread are not executed until this user defined thread, until this thread will get executed. Why? Because this is nothing but main thread, this is nothing but user level thread. In Java, we don't know in which order the threads will get executed. After executing one statement, again the remaining statements of the main thread may get executed. So in order to overcome that problem, what we are doing? We are calling t.join method. So whenever the statement is executed, then main thread will wait until the user thread completed its execution. Okay. So after completing the execution, control comes to the main method. Here we have the statement sum of upper is, what is the value of upper? 3. Sum of 3 is obj.getSum. So control goes to the getSum method of the this one, sum class, return sum. What is the sum value? 6. So 6 will be returned. So sum of 3 is 6 will print it. So in this way we can implement threads in C language with the help of Pthreads as well as in Java language. So this is about thread libraries in operating system.